All of you guys need to go to Praxis to drink beers.
For sure.
Because it's the thing that I am used to doing, so yeah. So I hope the intelligent guys forgive me about that. The good news is that most of the stuff that is that I'm going to show you tonight is also available in IntelliJ and NetBeans. Well, not yet in NetBeans, but they're working on it. Okay, so what is Forge? Forge came into history as a successor of a tool called SceneGem. Anyone knows about Scene? SceneGem was a tool that allowed you to quickly create a prototype, a web application using the Scene programming model. But at some point, Scene went out of, or Scene 2 actually went, became old, and Scene gradually transformed into CDI. Or at least CDI was one of the specs that, that is now in Java E that came out of the Scene project. And the need existed to have something like SceneGem for Java EE in general and even for at least it started like we want something like we have for Scene, but now for CDI and JSF and with you know all these Java EE technologies. Who is aware of Java EE? Aware, everybody is aware of it, right? Okay. Who uses Java EE? Okay, who doesn't? Spring? No? Spring? Okay. Who is a what kind of parts of Java EE does do you use CDI? Nobody? CDI? Who uses CDI? Okay, not a lot. JSF? No. JPA? Okay, most of you. Okay, yeah, that's cool. Okay. We talked about it earlier today. It's actually a shame that JSF. Okay, well, I will show you some JSF today, but JSF is not probably not the most interesting spec in Java EE, but CDI is very, very, very interesting, very powerful, and it's very underestimated. People should use it all the time, and they don't. And that's it's a pity because it's very powerful, it's very nice. Now, one of the things with Java EE, so yeah, I'm telling you that the Forge project came into existence because people wanted to do something similar like they did with Scene, but with Java EE. And you can see here, the picture that is drawn up there is a picture that I use already for the past 3 years, I guess. So it should be changed somehow recently because some new boxes should have been arrived already. But it's a picture that I took two or 3 years ago from the Oracle website that represented the Java EE spec, right? So all these boxes are different specs, right? All these boxes are frameworks. Now, how, as a beginner, how do you get started? Yeah, do you read, all these books all these specs to know what you have to do? No, you can't, because it's impossible. So it's that's a hard job. And Forge is a tool that, after the initial implementation of trying to help you get started with a CDI and JSF application, that allows you to get started with possibly all those boxes there. Yeah, that allows you to reduce startup costs if you want to use Java EE by enabling you to gradually add one of those boxes at a time. And because Forge knows all the details and all the integration details between all these different boxes, it can set your project up gradually one gradually one box at a time. That's actually the main idea of Forge. That was what is the main difference then between Forge 1 and Forge 2? Well, Forge 1 was basically a very command line oriented tool. Who likes the command line here? Not so much. Oh, I'm actually surprised about that. Okay, well, I mean,
I'm an
IDE user myself because I, you know, that's what I do. But, yeah, command line can be very fun and very productive. So Forge 1 was very command line oriented, but yeah, probably the proof is in the audience here. A lot of people are not attracted by command line. They are using an IDE and they want to have, you know, the functionality to create or to create projects and use the specs of the Java specs in the IDE itself, right? So it would be a pity that you write functionality to help people start it in the command line and then you have to rewrite it to get the same functionality in an IDE. You have to rewrite it for Eclipse, and you have to rewrite it for IntelliJ, and you have to rewrite it for NetBeans, and so on, right? So the main idea of Forge 2 was, no, we don't do that anymore. We're going to have a tool that can be embedded in IDEs. You write functionality one time, and it will be available on the command line and in all the IDEs that you fancy. And I hope that today I'm going to show you that, and I'm going to make you enthusiastic about that. So if you walk out of here, you know, 1 hour, 1 hour and a half from now, and you think by yourself, okay, this was a cool tool, I'm going to look at it in the next few weeks, then I think my mission is succeeded. Good. Okay, so this was also a slide from 3 years ago. It's still the same Forge. You're going to carve out a project and work it into shape. That's the motto. Any questions right now? No? Okay, so I'm going to now switch to coding, right? I hope you like coding. I'm going to try
and show you. Yeah, I'm used to it.
What did you say?
You are used to it.
You're used to it?
Okay. Yeah.
You don't want to do it in the evening anymore? Okay.
Come over here.
Good. This is what you see here is an instance of JMOS Developer Studio. It's some build that I picked. It's a CR1 build. 801 CR1 build that I picked from I don't even think it's public yet, but I picked it from one of our build servers a couple of days ago. Who knows what JMOS Developer Studio is? Not a lot. Really? Either. Okay. No, so JMOS Developer Studio is basically Eclipse, but in a good way. I mean, no. No, let me rephrase it. It is actually, so who knows what JMOS Tools is? The same people, okay. So JMOS Tools is Eclipse in a good way. Right? It means Eclipse, but with all the things that a developer that wants to target the modern frameworks needs, you know, like mobile development, HTML5, REST, all those typical things that you need nowadays in the Java spec, on a typical Java application. They are not available in a plain vanilla Eclipse, not even in a plain vanilla Eclipse Java E distribution, but with all the things that are provided on top of that in JMOS Tools, you know, you can really, you can do hibernate and all the stuff that you expect to do.
Yeah.
It's not available in the plain vanilla Eclipse version. So JBoss Developer Studio is the productized version of JBoss Tools, basically. So this thing is a product. If you have a subscription and you pay, then you get support. It means that it also means that I don't show it here, but you can have a JBoss Developer Studio with JBoss EAP, the Enterprise Application Server, application platform, embedded, and it means that you can really develop against the proper supported target, right? And you can get support from that. Right. This is the sales pitch, right? I'm not going to use the enterprise application platform. I'm going to use a community project here, Wildfly. Yeah. Who knows about Wildfly? Okay. So this is also a very recent version that came out a couple of weeks ago, Wildfly 8.2, and that's the one I'm going to use for my demo today. You see here that in the JBoss 8.01, we have Forge 2.12.3, 2.12.3 that is embedded. So we are at Forge 2, not Forge 2.0 anymore, but Forge 2.12.3. We can start it either by clicking on this thing here, or by using the key combination command 4. And I cannot show you. You would have to see my fingers. But if I do command 4, then I'm going to start JBoss Forge, and it's going to display a list of.
What is the startup time of the server?
What?
How many seconds the startup time?
Of Forge?
Yeah.
I don't know, we saw it probably 3 or 4 seconds.
3 or 4 seconds?
Yeah.
That's good.
Depends on your machine. I mean, and how many, because I'm now...
Because you are used to about 30, 40 seconds with JBoss.
Oh, the JBoss server?
Yeah.
Application server?
Yeah.
Well, that should be like 3 seconds nowadays, yeah.
3 seconds.
Maybe not on my machine, because it's an old machine.
So it's a huge boost of improvement.
Yeah, JBoss AS, since AS7, this has been dramatically improved.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, but in practice, what is happening there? You are spawning a new process, a new JVM. What it means starting the forge?
No. So there's no process started. It's actually a container that is started, but it runs in the same VM as Eclipse.
Okay.
Yeah. Of course, if you run it in the command line, then you will have a
separate process,
right? Yeah. This is what happened with Forge 1 indeed was a separate process. So we had a separate process that was the same thing, the integration, the JBoss Tools integration, ran a separate process that was integrated through complicated text-based communication channel.
Okay.
But now it all runs within the same virtual machine, and we can communicate really, you know, using Java technology. Basically, there's no remote communication going
on. Okay. Operators.
Yeah. So these are the different options that you get initially. They are what they are. These are the things that you can start graphically, right? You see here that it has started some command line thingy in the bottom there, right? So you could actually use it as a command line tool as well within the Eclipse environment. I could just do a tab, you know, if I hit tab, then it will write out all the possible commands that I can use in the command line, right? Okay, but let's use the wizards here. I'm going to start by creating a new project. Most of the stuff that I'm going to show today is available online. So if you want to review it later, you know, it's It's available and it's somewhere on our docs website.
I think it's on GitHub. Hmm? I think it's on GitHub.
It's in GitHub, yeah, but I can probably show the URL. Or
yeah, I'll publish them on the end. Cool. Or my mailing list.
So we're going to give this a name, CD bookstore. And I'm going to accept all the defaults, so it basically says top level is an org example. And when I hit finish, it just creates a project. It will import it in Eclipse, and it gives a message that the thing has happened. If I could create the same thing here, right? I could do project new, and then if I hit that, it gives me all the possible things that I can use. Names, pet store, for instance, or food. And then it will create a full project and import it here in my Eclipse environment. So basically this is the same, you can use it on the command line or at using the wizards.
This is being created in workspace folder, right?
What?
In which folder in the file system is it being created?
Yes, so if you do nothing, it's just in the workspace folder. If nothing, you can create a location, you can specify the location, it will create a project in that location, and it will still import the project to your workspace.
So I can CD to that location,
yes,
and create the project,
yeah,
there.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
And the wizard creates, the visual wizard creates the project where...
If I'm not mistaken, I'm going to delete this one first.
My question is, if I CD in the console, and then change to the wizard, it will create in the...
No. The wizard and the console are not really
so
aware of one another.
Okay, so the
I
wizard...
I can CD to level it up here, right?
Okay.
And then if I use this one, and I do project new, then it will
okay.
still... It will still yeah, you're right. The project location would be there. Yeah.
Okay, so it's in sync.
That's cool. Yeah.
Okay.
I thought that, yeah, that's strange. I mean, I thought that I'm going to change it. Anyway. Okay, so we created a project, and I was promising you that we were going to do some CDI. So the first thing that you need to do, or some Java EE, the first thing that we need to do is set up JPA. To create some JPA entities in the project. So we can here, you can see that now I have a lot more options here all of a sudden, right? Mm-hmm. See that? So if I have this guy, nothing is selected. I have these options. And if I select a project, I have a lot more options. That's because the commands that are available in Forge are aware of the current selection. So if I have a project selected, I can create way more stuff. I need JPA entities, and I can do that by setting up here. Okay, the wizard will ask me, you know, which JPA version do you need, which container do you want to target, so it's 2.0, 2.1, which container do you want to target, I'm going to use Wildfly in this case, which provider do you want to use, Hibernate or all the other ones, let's use Hibernate 4X. And the following thing, I can choose my database, the data source, and change these generation types, change the persistent gene name and so on. Okay, let's just finish. And Forge will just create my persistence of XML with the specified data. So, how, you know, normally, this is something you would have to, you know, a typical beginner would just go to Google and try to look what the thing is that you can specify there and how you would specify it. So with Forge, this all becomes really easy. You just type JPS setup and it will provide you with all the details that you otherwise would have to look for. Yeah.
One question. When you choose the data source, the Forge also edits your standalone.xml, the configuration file of wildfire.
No.
So you have to create the data source.
So if you want another data source, then you need to manually or you need to create another data source for wildfire to deploy with your application. But you can. So there are ways to do this. I mean, there are wizards in JVDS to create data source configuration files for wildfire.
Okay.
So is there a way to know which command the wizard, the visual wizard, executed? So we can repeat it later on the console instead of the wizard.
Can you
so you have opened the wizard and set up JPA.
Yes.
That resulted in a command sent to Forge.
Right.
Can we know that command so we can write it manually?
Yeah, so that's interesting because one of the open issues is that we need to find a way to, or we need to add a feature that basically logs all the commands that we do on the wizards so that you can repeat it, for instance, at the command.
Yeah, for learning and be quicker.
But the question will be, well, I'm going to talk about scripting and that's going to address some of that. But indeed, the logging, the automatic logging, will be very interesting, it's not there yet. Okay, so let's then create an entity. So one of the entities that we can create is a book, right? So one of the things also is like, you know, you can look here, right? Entity. Okay, JPN entity. So this field can enable you to narrow down the list to what you really want to do. So we're going to create a book here. We'll accept all the details. Yeah. Okay. So it has created the book entity. It has automatically chosen the ID and so on. And now we can add some fields there. For instance, like description fields.
Sorry to ask you, that's an Eclipse plugin, isn't it?
This is all Forge.
This is all Forge.
Yeah.
Forge plugin.
Yeah. So I created now a new field description with a length 2000, right?
Okay.
So it has created this thing. You see it has added
J2AE.
The constraint there. I can as well go here and you see that, you know, there is like a redrawing in this console. The console is not really at
fire system
top speed right now, to say the least. We have issues with it. Yeah, it works, but there are speed issues and it doesn't work like it should work. We changed our console from the base of our console from JLine to Ash. Ash is a JBoss project. I mean, some JBoss guy that made this. And while the flexibility of Ash is way better, the performance is absolutely not as good. So I think, well, at least that's my explanation. But maybe there's something else that I'm not aware of. Good. But anyway, you can hit here. You could JPA new field, right? Named, let's say, what is the one here that we have?
SVN.
Voice, for instance. No name. No. Title. So title. Title. And it's a string as well. So I can.
You prefer to specify the entity.
Okay, so yeah, it asks me which entity should do I need to a view.
From the command line, you can create database scripts or just plain Java objects that will be translated to GPA database.
What do you mean by database scripts?
Well, like SQL.
We don't have like SQL add-on yet, but I imagine you can write one. So I mean, I want to show you how to write add-ons. So you could write add-ons, I think, that run SQL scripts.
Okay.
Or that are able to interpret SQL. I mean, you need to find a proper format to do it. And you could do, like we run scripts, like you can run Forge scripts. You could probably also try to run SQL scripts or execute SQL scripts with a SQL execute command or something like that.
That will be translated from
JavaScript. Yeah, you actually define a script and not a file, or maybe in a string that is a parameter that is quoted or something like that.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So so we have now a book with two fields. Scaffold generate, right? And we can use a scaffold type. Okay, I'm going to use faces. We can choose between faces and AngularJS. I'm going to use AngularJS in a minute, but I'm going to use faces right now. And I'm going to use a webroot part that is called JSF. I'm not going to stick by the default. And this is going to be a little bit of a problem. You can see that, you will see it later, because a landing page gives you a problem for some reason. But otherwise, I don't have a way to differentiate between Angular and faces. Okay, so you're going to choose faces. It asks me, yeah, to use faces, I need to use CDI, I need to use EJB, I need to use the servlet spec, I need to use the JSF spec, of course, and it presents me with all the possible, with a number of pre-configured combination of version numbers, which I'm going to accept by default, but you can tweak with it and change it if you want to. And then it finds out about all the entities that are in my project right now. Currently it's only resources.
JSF.
Some JSF, sorry. Under JSF, I have a landing, index landing page and then four XHTML facelift pages, facelifts that contain my user interface, right? Okay, so when this is done, I can just, I can actually, I don't need to do that, I can click here and say full publish.
Yeah, I'm used to command line interface.
You're used to the command line?
Yeah, very used to it.
Okay. So, but now it has, so redeploy this application, and I could go to open up a browser here. HTTP, localhost. And you see it gives it this error here, but somehow it works because
yeah, you can see JBoss Forge open page error.
Yeah, of course, I'm going to do the best choice here to open it in the Eclipse. So let me close this. So you have a very easy way to create a JSF user interface very quickly. Now, let's to do something else here. We could also do REST. Right? Who has known about REST? Okay, well, most of you. Okay, so if you we could just do the REST interface here. Yeah.
Before you go you want to customize the UI,
yes.
You can do it, or if you want to add a button, you can't use the scaffolding anymore.
No, so yeah, if you start that's also normal, I guess. If you start but the thing is, if you generate once approach, right? But what you always can do is save the commands as scripts, right? As a script, and then regenerate all of it, and then you have like a meta programming type of language, that's the Forge command language, and you can regenerate and then mess with it, and if you're not happy, then you just just throw it away and you regenerate, you just regenerate everything.
Right. Because I had that problem with JBoss Sim. Since I need the new button, I can't use the scaffolding anymore.
No, that's kind of normal because it's a very hard problem to regenerate. Knowing, I know of some tools that can do it, but it's always a bit quirky.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So
right.
We chose not to support it.
Thank you.
Okay. That's my wife calling. So REST, we can do REST here. Set it up. Generate the book endpoints. We accept all the defaults. Generate all the REST endpoints. And then there's something very interesting that you can do in JDBS. There's a little view called a web service tester. So you could just, if you get something. Of course, I have to redeploy this with all the REST stuff that I generated. Right? But after redeploying, because of course there's no books in here anymore since the redeployment. I can show you what was going on here. In the persistence of XML, there is the HBR to DDL auto option that says create drop. So when I redeploy, it basically erased everything that was in the database. So if I want to see here something, I need to put something back in there. Or is JSF, right? Okay, so this is really, you can see that all these things work, you can test it right away.
Sorry, I didn't get it. Where is that storage stated?
The storage?
Yes.
Is a embedded H2 database that is in the
Forge. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So there is a default DS in the Wildfire server that is there by default, and that's the one I'm targeting with this application. The default DS is linked to a H2 database.
H2 database, okay.
Right. Okay. We can actually do something more complicated. I'm going to try to show you this. That's I have something running here. There is a local HT database that is running, and I try and find the server that should start earlier. And there is actually a lot of data in that database present already. And I want to show you that you can just, you know, reverse engineer from an existing database. I think it's the one here. So it's a database that, you know, basically contains information about films and actors and rentals from these movies, right?
That is also an Eclipse plugin. Hmm? It's an Eclipse
this
plugin.
The Squirrel SQL client is
a, oh, it's a Squirrel.
It's a separate. Oh. It's a separate. It's a separate.
Okay,
separate.
Okay, I know that.
Okay, but I just want to show you that there's data in this database, right? I can
at the UI or the overall design, how can you classify it?
Well, you can just go in the HTML or in the UI. Okay, so this is actually the idea. If you would be able to create a script like that,